Classic Case Studies in Psychology. Fourth edition by Geoff Rolls. Read by Ric Jerrom. Introduction. This is a strange book, full of even stranger stories. Psychology is a fascinating subject with many fascinating stories to tell, but the most fascinating stories are told by case studies. They range from stories of people with no memory to stories of people who can't forget. Stories of wild, abandoned children to stories of child prodigies. Without doubt, these are the most interesting aspects of psychology. They can also be the most revealing in terms of furthering our understanding of human behaviour. The problem is, we all want to know more than is available in the textbooks. Scientific journals concentrate on the scientific aspects, when we also want to know what happened on an everyday human level. What was it like to do that? What was it like for the individuals concerned? How did they feel? How did they cope? What happened next? This book tries to bridge that gap. Important findings in psychology have often been discovered first through one-off case studies. Such case studies always fascinate both the psychology student and the lay reader alike. The use of the case study method helps bring psychology to life. It puts a human angle to psychological ideas. Psychologists continue to argue about the scientific status of psychology. There is little doubt that scientific findings tend to be given greater credence than hearsay or subjective experiences. However, when it comes to the human mind and behaviour, it can be difficult to conduct scientifically controlled experiments that don't break ethical and moral boundaries. This is where the use of case studies can be particularly useful. They enable the scientist to investigate avenues of the mind and behaviour that are not ordinarily available. By exploring the extraordinary, we can learn much about the ordinary. The use of the case study method in psychology has a long tradition. Indeed, it is one of the very earliest methods, and Itard's first report on the enfant sauvage dates back to 1801, as we'll see in Chapter 9. In recent years, there have been numerous books giving unique insights into people's unusual deficits or excesses. However, these books tend to be written by neurologists, and the case studies relate to patients they have met during their medical careers. This book is different in that it provides more detail on the most famous case studies in psychology, the studies that are in many of the psychology textbooks. Of course, entire books and numerous papers have been written about some of the more famous ones, but here, each chapter is condensed into a more easily digestible chunk, dealing with the most interesting and revealing aspects of each case. In addition to the scientific importance of each case study, the human aspect of each person's experience is included. The hope is that we will begin to understand the people presented in the case studies as humans with a unique ability or difficulty, rather than merely as scientific case studies. Professor Luria, who worked at the Moscow State University, outlined two contrasting approaches to the study of human behaviour. These he called classical and romantic science. Classical science has the aim of formulating abstract general laws, which can result in the reduction of living reality with all its richness of detail to abstract schema. He noted that this has become more and more pronounced with the advent of computers, in that observations can now be reduced to complex mathematical analysis. This book seeks to adopt the so-called romantic or literary science view. The stories have a scientific point and help to illustrate areas of psychology, but are written from a human viewpoint. They are human stories. Case studies are used extensively in law, business, and medicine, but their use is less common in psychology. This is a shame, since we often seem to remember the case studies most vividly because they help to humanize science, as well as illustrating psychological findings. A case study involves gathering detailed information about an individual or group. It will usually include biographical details, as well as details of the behavior or experiences of interest. Case studies allow a researcher to examine a particular individual in far greater depth than experimental methods of investigation. Case studies lend themselves to so-called qualitative research methods, and thus findings are not easily reported in a numerical fashion. Written descriptive reports are often used. These outline what the person feels or believes about a particular issue. These methods tend to be criticized as being less scientific and less worthy than more rigorous experimental methods using statistical analysis. An additional criticism leveled at case studies is that sometimes the researcher conducting the study may be biased in their interpretations or reporting method. This subjectivity means that it could be difficult to determine factual information from researcher inference. An awareness of this does not detract from the stories that emerge. Indeed, much of the rich detail from the first-hand accounts would not have been possible had the researchers not formed warm and friendly relationships with their participants. This might be viewed as a strength of the approach, not a weakness. Case studies can help shed light on both specific and general psychological issues. Case studies allow psychologists to study behaviors or experiences that are so unique that they could not have been studied in any other way. Examples in this book illustrate this. These case studies allow the researcher to explore possibilities in human behavior that may not have been previously considered or thought possible. Often, a case study can span several different areas of psychology. With this in mind, readers may argue about the grouping of the case studies into specific approaches. Does the David Reimer case cross from developmental psychology into both social and physiological psychology, and perhaps even further? I will leave the listener to be the judge of this. Thus, these headings may be a little artificial, but at least they illustrate how case studies are drawn from many different areas of psychology. Bromley, in 1986, has argued that case studies are the bedrock of scientific investigation, and that psychologists' preoccupation with experimental procedures has led to a neglect of this area. Case studies have the advantage of providing greater depth and understanding about an individual and acknowledge and celebrate human diversity. Because case studies are about real, genuine people, they have a special feeling of truth about them. This helps to make them memorable. However, case studies are also criticized for being unreliable. No two case studies are alike, and therefore results cannot be easily generalized to other people. The question arises as to whether we always have to find out universal truths of behavior. Sometimes, surely, it's enough to explore the lives of unique individuals. Students of psychology will recognize many of the stories, but will want to know more. Those new to psychology will find it a useful and interesting introduction to the greatest mystery of all: understanding the human mind and human behavior in all its facets. Part 1. Cognitive Psychology. Chapter 1. The Man Who Couldn't Forget. The Story of Solomon Sherishevsky. S. One day in 1905, a 19-year-old Moscow newspaper reporter called Solomon Sherishevsky turned up for work as usual and waited for the daily meeting with the editor of the paper, during which assignments for the day would be given out. Unlike any of his colleagues, but as was his usual practice, Solomon did not take any notes about the meeting. The editor had noticed this before with surprise, and this time decided to reproach Solomon. After all, often there were numerous names and addresses given out, and Solomon ought to record the details. The editor decided to test Solomon by asking for details of what he had said. Solomon proceeded to repeat all that he had been told, word for word. This incident changed Solomon's life forever and was the starting point of his new career as the world's greatest mnemonist, or memory man. Solomon's memory. The editor was amazed by Solomon's memory, whereas Solomon was amazed that anyone should think his memory was remarkable. Didn't others have equally good memories? The answer he would discover over the coming months and years. Sensing an interesting story, the editor sent Solomon to the local university for some further tests of his memory ability. And this is where he met Alexander Romanovich Luria, a Russian professor who was to spend the next 30 years systematically studying the most remarkable memory ever examined. Luria started the examination by collecting biographical details. Solomon, a Latvian by birth, was in his late 20s. His father owned a bookstore, and therefore, not surprisingly, his mother was well-read. His father could apparently recall the location of every book in the store, and his mother, a devout Jew, could quote long paragraphs from the Torah. His brothers and sisters were well-balanced individuals, and there was evidence of some musical talent within the family. Indeed, Solomon trained as a violinist until an ear infection put paid to that choice of profession, and he turned to journalism instead. Given the suggested link between exceptional ability and mental illness, Luria noted no history of mental illness in the family. Luria began by giving Solomon a series of tests to ascertain his memory capacity. Words and numbers were presented to him in spoken or written form, and he had to replicate them in their original form. Luria started with 10 or 20 items, but increased this gradually to 70 items. Solomon recalled all the items perfectly. Solomon occasionally hesitated with his answers and stared into space, paused, but then continued with the word perfect recall. Solomon could also report the letters or numbers in reverse order, or determine which letter or number followed another in a sequence. This is known as a serial probe technique, whereby a list of letters or numbers is read out, and then one item is repeated, and the item that follows has to be recalled. This can be conducted as a test of short-term memory. Recall duration of up to about 30 seconds. Most people find this task extremely difficult, especially with a long sequence of items. But Solomon had no difficulty, providing that the initial presentation of the list was at a pace that he dictated. This pace tended to be fairly slow, which is the exact opposite of so-called normal participants, who tend to perform slightly better on a serial probe task if the items are presented quickly. This is because, with normal participants, the quicker the presentation, the less time the items have to decay in their short-term memory. However, with Solomon, it was discovered that he was using a different system for remembering the items, not one based on normal acoustic or sound processing, but one that involved images or pictures. This also meant that, once learned, Solomon would remember the sequence of items indefinitely, whereas most normal participants would have little recall for the items beyond the minutes that the experiment would take. Luria began to present Solomon with different memory tasks. Most people find meaningful words far easier to recall than nonsense syllables or trigrams, three consonants with no meaning. But Solomon had no problem with any of them. The same findings occurred with sounds and numbers. All Solomon required was a 3 or 4 second delay between each item to be recalled. In order to test the capacity of memory, researchers have devised a technique developed originally by Joseph Jacobs in 1887 called the serial digit span technique. This involves gradually increasing the items to be remembered until the participant becomes confused and can no longer recall the items in the correct order. If you try this, you'll find that the typical digit span is 7, plus or minus 2 items. However, with Solomon, it was Luria who became confused, since Solomon appeared to have no limit to his digit span. Indeed, Luria had to give up in the end, since there appeared to be no limit to his memory capacity. Luria arranged for Solomon to return to the university for further tests of his memory. At these sessions, Solomon could recall perfectly all the previous items he had learned. These results confused Luria even more, since Solomon seemed to have no limit either to the capacity of his memory or to the durability of the traces he retained. As Luria wrote in 1968, "I soon found myself in a state verging on utter confusion. An increase in the length of a series led to no noticeable increase in difficulty for S, and I simply had to admit that the capacity of his memory had no distinct limits." Luria couldn't measure either the capacity or duration of Solomon's memory, both of which can usually be tested fairly easily in a laboratory. Indeed, even more amazingly, Luria found out 16 years later that Solomon could recall the items learned at his original sessions. Luria reports Solomon saying, "Yes, yes, this was a series you once gave me when we were in your apartment. You were sitting at the table and I in the rocking chair. You were wearing a grey suit and you looked at me like this. Now, then, I can see you saying..." This gives a clue as to how Solomon's memory worked. Images were the key to his remarkable memory. Luria had a problem. He realized that there was no way to measure Solomon's memory since it seemed to have no capacity limit. A quantitative analysis of his memory was impossible. For the next 30 years, he decided to concentrate on describing Solomon's memory, to provide a qualitative account of its structure. Solomon used one particular mechanism to aid his memory. Regardless of the type of information or its form, words, numbers, sounds, tastes, and so on, Solomon always converted these items into visual images. Providing Solomon was given the time to convert the items into images, there was no limit to the capacity or duration of his memories. A table of 50 random numbers would typically take him about 3 minutes to commit to memory. How was this done? Solomon stated that if numbers were written on paper, when asked to recall them later, he would recall the image he had of the paper and recall them as though he was still staring at it. If you were to stop reading and try to report all that you could see if you glanced up from the page, you would probably recall only a fraction of what you actually saw. For Solomon, his recall was as though he was still looking at the page. Solomon could still picture the page in his mind's eye in perfect detail. Many memory tasks work on the basis of errors made during recall. Such memory experiments are called substitution error studies. Mistakes that are made during recall often provide a clue as to how the memory works. It would be wrong to give the impression that Solomon never made any mistakes. They did not occur that often, and they were usually of a similar type, and they give us a further clue as to how his memory worked. For example, Solomon occasionally misread one number for another, especially if the numbers appeared similar, i.e. 3 and 8, or 2 and 7. Such errors again suggested that his memory was almost exclusively dependent on visual or so-called orthographic processing. When given a list of words or numbers to recall, normal people often recall the first and last items on the list. Recall of the first items is called the primacy effect, and the last is called the recency effect. This pattern of recall is known as the serial position effect. It is suggested that the first words have been transferred to long-term memory through rehearsal, and the last items on the list are still held in short-term memory. Once again, as with Solomon's duration and capacity of memory, Luria did not record this phenomenon, since Solomon could recall all the items wherever they appeared on a list. Solomon had the most amazing memory. Indeed, he had memories dating back to childhood that few of us possess. It is suggested that our memories of our first few years aren't recalled because we haven't learned to encode the material due to a lack of development in terms of memory and/or speech. However, Solomon encoded his memories in a different way, and since this ability was innate, he possessed it at a very early age. Solomon reported memories from lying in his cot as an infant when his mother picked him up. "I was very young then, not even a year old, perhaps. What comes to mind most clearly is the furniture in the room. I remember that the wallpaper in the room was brown and the bed white. I can see my mother taking me in her arms." He even recalls his smallpox vaccination. "I remember a mass of fog, then of colours. I know this means there was noise, most likely conversation, but I don't feel any pain." Of course, it's impossible to discover the accuracy of these memories, but their vividness certainly suggests an element of truth. With such an amazing memory, Solomon was brilliant at spotting contradictions in stories, often pointing out things that the writers had failed to notice. He reports a character in the Chekhov story entitled Fat and Thin, who takes off his cap, where earlier he is mentioned as having not worn a cap. Given his precise ability, one might have imagined Solomon becoming a detective or lawyer. Solomon could see every detail and could not fail to spot any contradictions. Synesthesia. Luria reports that Solomon often had difficulty with encoding or processing information if there was a distraction during the encoding process. This included the experimenter merely saying yes or no to indicate whether Solomon had heard an item correctly. Solomon reported that these words blurred the image in his head and created puffs of steam or splashes, which made it more difficult for him to see the items. Later, during his stage shows, coughs in the audience would have a similar distracting effect. It seemed that all information created an image in Solomon's head, regardless of whether or not he wanted it to. Psychologists have consistently shown that the use of imagery is a particularly effective technique for improving long-term memory. Solomon seemed to have a particular visual ability related to synesthesia. Synesthesia comes from the Greek words syn, meaning together, and esthesis, meaning perception. Synesthesia is, therefore, a form of combined perception where two or more senses become intertwined. This means that when one of the senses is stimulated, it automatically triggers another sense that acts involuntarily. For example, days of the week may be associated with particular colours. A student of mine states that Tuesday is definitely a blue day. When asked why, most synesthetes just say that it just is. There's no explanation for why the senses intertwine. Other synesthetes might taste shapes or see sounds. These experiences are always the same. The same stimuli consistently evoke the same reactions. This is because they are not learned. They just occur naturally. Synesthesia tends to be one-directional, meaning one sense may spark off another sense, but it doesn't tend to work the other way round. Since synesthesia is the crossing of two or more senses, there are 31 different possible combinations of sight, smell, touch, taste, and hearing. The most common combination tends to be colour and hearing, chromesthesia. Most synesthetes experience the fusion of only two senses, but Solomon appeared to have four senses joined. Only his sense of smell did not intertwine with his other senses. The ability Solomon possessed to form visual images for words was the key to his remarkable memory recall. Whenever he heard a word, whether it made sense or not, an immediate visual image was created. He reported that if he heard the word green, he would see a green flower pot. With the word red, he would see a man in a red shirt waving towards him. Blue conjured up an image of someone waving a blue flag from a window. Even nonsense words conjured up immediate visual impressions that he could continue to see clearly years later. When Solomon was asked to listen to tones or voices, he saw images. An example of this is the report he gave when asked to listen to a tone of 30 cycles per second at 100 decibels. "I saw a strip 12 to 15 centimetres in width, the colour of tarnished silver. Gradually, this strip narrowed and seemed to recede. Then it was converted into an object that glistened like steel." Such examples clearly show how his synesthesia worked. Repetition of the tones months later led to exactly the same images being recalled. Every sound he heard summoned up a memorable visual image with its own distinct form, colour, and taste. Solomon's recall of numbers worked in a similar way. He reported the shape of the number 1 as being pointed, firm, and complete. The number 2 as being flatter, rectangular, whitish in colour, sometimes almost a grey. Numbers also produced more concrete images. The number 1 was a proud, well-built man. The number 2 was a high-spirited woman, and so on. For Solomon, vision, taste, touch, and hearing all merged together. Later on in his career, as a professional mnemonist, audiences tested him with nonsense words or foreign languages. And even these unfamiliar words produced sensations of taste, touch, or vision. These additional bits of extra information helped to cue his recall. Solomon even reported an association with the weight of a word. For Solomon, these sensations were so vivid that he reported, "I don't have to make an effort to remember it. The word seems to recall itself." The method of loci. The method of loci is a mnemonic memory enhancement technique that Solomon used in order to remember items in a particular sequence. The method of loci refers to objects to be remembered that are imagined in known locations and dates back to ancient Greece, where orators would use it to remember long speeches. A story that is associated with this technique relates to the orator Simonides of Chios, who was due to give a speech at a banquet in the 5th century BC. In order to receive a message, he left the building, whereupon the hall collapsed. All the guests were killed and their bodies were unidentifiable. Using the method of loci, Simonides was able to locate the bodies of the guests based on where he had last seen them in the building. The relatives were thus able to identify their relatives' remains. This shows not only how useful the method can be, but how important it is to pay attention to messages. In order to use the method of loci, you need to imagine a familiar route or location. Solomon often used a street or road in his hometown in Latvia, or a well-known route in Moscow, such as Gorky Street. Once imagined, the images to be remembered need to be placed at points on the walk. Items are thus distributed at various locations, such as in houses, by gates, trees, or shop windows, the loci. In order to recall the list, you need to retrace your steps and see the items placed there. Solomon's amazing visual memory meant that he had no difficulty retracing these walks. For him, it was as though he was actually walking along the route. On the few occasions when he failed to recall an item, he explained that he had placed the item in a location which made it difficult to see on retracing the route. Sometimes he placed the items in a dimly lit spot, say, in the shadow of a tree, and therefore he would not notice the item in question. For Solomon, these mistakes were defects of perception, not seeing them on the route, rather than defects of memory. One example of this involved the word egg, which he placed against a white wall, and then failed to spot on retracing his steps. When Solomon later became a mnemonist, he became more careful at placing objects in appropriate places, and mistakes such as these became rarer. Memory performance. When it became clear to Solomon that people might be interested in his memory ability, he quit his newspaper job and became a professional mnemonist, performing his memory feats on stage. Audiences often tried to catch him out by giving him nonsense or made-up words to recall. Although Solomon found he could do this, all the visualizations that he had to make to recall these words meant that he took quite a long time to process the information. He recalls one of his most difficult performances when he was asked to recall a long series of repetitive syllables, over 50, such as ma, va, na, sa, va, ma, and so on. Solomon stated, "No sooner had I heard the first word than I found myself on a road in the forest near the little village of Malta, where my family had a summer cottage when I was a child. The third word, damn it, the same consonants again. I knew I was in trouble. I was going to have to change paths in the woods for each word, but it would take more time. And when you're on stage, each second counts. I could see someone smiling in the audience, and this, too, immediately was converted into an image of a sharp spire, so that I felt as if I'd been stabbed in the heart." Despite these reservations, Solomon still managed to reproduce the sequence correctly. 8 years later, and without prior warning, Luria asked Solomon to repeat this monotonous list of syllables, and he had no difficulty whatsoever. As a mnemonist, Solomon tried to simplify his recall techniques in order to speed up his memory performance. As mentioned, he ensured that mental images were clearly seen, and he also developed a shorthand system of his images. He tried to create images that were more simple and less detailed. Solomon found that he could still recall the words, and that the less detailed images took less time to encode. With nonsense syllables that audiences gave him to recall, he linked image associations with lots of different syllables. He worked on this for hours each day and became a master at forming images of nonsense syllables. Using such techniques, he could recall words in a foreign language, meaningless mathematical formulae and nonsense syllables. Luria was adamant that Solomon's memory was an innate characteristic that he had been born with. The use of mnemonic techniques during his stage performances were simply devices to enhance and speed up his natural ability to satisfy a demanding audience. Other associated abilities. Solomon's incredible visual memory ensured that he could perform bodily feats due to the power of thought. As he put it, "If I want something to happen, I simply picture it in my mind." This was no idle boast, and he could regulate his heartbeat and even alter his perception of pain through imagery. To alter his heartbeat, he merely had to imagine that he was running for a train, or imagine he was lying perfectly still and relaxing in bed. These images were so real for him that his body altered its physiological responses. In addition, he was able to alter the temperature of his hands by imagining placing one of them in a hot stove while holding ice in the other hand. Recordings of the temperature of the skin on each hand showed that they had changed by a couple of degrees. In addition, Solomon could alter his perception of pain. While at the dentist, he would imagine watching someone else having their teeth drilled. This meant that the other person experienced the pain, not Solomon. He could also adapt his eyes to the dark by imagining himself in a darkened room and could produce a cochlear pupil reflex using his imagination of hearing a piercing sound. Despite being studied at a specialist neurology clinic, few explanations for these abilities were forthcoming. Memory problems. It is clear by now that Solomon possessed a unique memory. However, there were downsides to his abilities. Due to the abundance of images that were associated with each word he heard, he had to have information read to him fairly slowly in order for him to process the word as an image. Apparently, on meeting Solomon for the first time, many people reported him as appearing rather disorganized, dull, or slow-witted. This was certainly true if he was read a story at a fast pace. Solomon found that the array of images each word created meant that they collided with the images of the reading voice and those of any extraneous sounds. The result would be a complete chaos of images. A simple passage of writing sometimes became a Herculean effort of processing. Skim reading a passage, or taking just the gist of a passage, seemed beyond him, since each word summoned up such a rich array of images. Solomon found it impossible to single out the most important or key points from a text. Each detail in any text produced further images that often took him further and further away from the central point of any passage. Solomon was also very poor at processing abstract ideas. To Solomon, everything was processed visually. He said, "Other people think as they read, but I see it all." He often found that one word in a passage sparked off an image, and then from that image he would move to a related one not associated with the original text. His own thinking would guide his linked images rather than the text itself. abstract words were a real problem as well, since they could not easily be visualized. For example, he said that it was impossible to see the word infinity. He saw the word something as a dense cloud of steam and nothing as a thinner, completely transparent cloud. In effect, he could not grasp an idea or word unless he could see it, and some ideas and words cannot be easily visualized. Solomon's torment was to spend many hours of his life trying to grapple with these things that the rest of us cope with quite easily. Solomon was spectacularly poor at coping with synonyms or metaphors due to the images that crowded in on him. To him, a child, youngster, infant, toddler, and so on meant many different things, whereas a writer might use them interchangeably without a great deal of thought. To Solomon, they were processed in completely different ways. Furthermore, words with many alternative meanings, such as wear, as in to wear away or to wear a coat, would cause serious problems, since the image would always be the same despite the different meanings. Often Solomon would get so bogged down in the detail that he couldn't see the overall picture. Poetry was almost impossible for him to read. Every word would form an image, whether or not it was the one that the poet intended, and the image Solomon saw would, more often than not, disguise the associated meaning. Another skill that Solomon was also particularly poor at was spotting any form of logical organization of material. Solomon did not readily spot patterns that might have aided recall. Indeed, he never used any logical means of recall at all. Solomon's over-reliance on imagery techniques meant that he often didn't take notice of the meaning of many words. Once, he was given a list of bird names to recall. He recalled the list perfectly, but failed to note that it was a list of different birds. His imagery technique meant that each word conjured up one or more separate images, and these were disconnected from the next word in the list. The same thing happened when he was given numbers that followed a particular sequence. Solomon usually failed to spot any logical sequence. Indeed, he commented, "If I had been given the letters of the alphabet arranged in a similar order, I wouldn't have noticed their arrangement. I simply would have gone on and memorized them." Perhaps surprisingly, Solomon had a fairly poor memory for faces or voices heard on the telephone. He complained that faces and voices were so changeable and depended on the mood or expression they had at the time. Solomon saw faces as constantly changing. The recognition of faces was compared to watching a wave changing its shape. Solomon claimed that a person's voice could change as much as 30 times a day. Each voice change produced a different set of images for Solomon, and hence recognition of one voice was difficult. Indeed, he was known to become so preoccupied by the sound of a person's voice that he didn't register what they were actually saying. Of course, this might be seen as an advantage with some people. Solomon's synesthesia enabled him to have a phenomenal memory, but the lack of a dividing line between his senses did result in rather strange occurrences. For example, he reported that in order to eat in a restaurant, there had to be the right kind of background music playing. Otherwise, the sound of the music would interfere with the taste of the food. Solomon stated that, if you select the right kind of music, everything tastes good. Surely people who work in restaurants know this. One occasion is reported when he fancied eating an ice cream and went to buy one from a nearby store. However, when asking what flavours were available, the ice cream seller replied, "Fruit ice cream," in such a tone of voice that a whole pile of coals, of black cinders, came bursting out of her mouth, and I couldn't bring myself to buy any ice cream after she'd answered that way. Another example of this concerns the Russian word svinya, which stands for pig. For Solomon, this word evoked fine and delicate images, quite at odds with the qualities usually associated with pigs. For Solomon, both the sound of a word, the voice of the speaker, and the meaning of the word would be encoded together. For Solomon, all of these things had to fit together. Trying to forget. Unlike most people who spend time trying to devise strategies for remembering, Solomon spent time trying to devise strategies to forget. It became increasingly clear to him that he needed to forget information. After becoming a professional mnemonist, when he would give several performances a day in the same venue, Solomon found that he was having difficulty organizing all the material he had to remember. Solomon developed a number of strategies to try to overcome this. First, he deliberately tried to restrict the images that he used to aid recall. He tried to focus his attention and limit the images to the essential details that he would need to recall the item to be remembered. In effect, he began to make shorthand versions of his images. He still remembered the material perfectly, but did not need to encode all the rich details that each item would normally evoke. Although this helped, he still needed a way to completely forget material, rather than just code things in a simpler form. One way he tried to forget was to mentally rearrange material on paper that he had remembered on previous performances. He then imagined screwing up the paper and throwing it away. However, he still reported difficulties of forgetting. Solomon found interference occurred if material in a subsequent performance was similar to that presented during an earlier performance. This is an example of proactive interference, where older memories affect newer memories. Furthermore, the more similarities between the material, the greater the interference. For once, Solomon's memory seemed to work like everyone else's, since interference is one of the suggested explanations for forgetting. Although it must still be recorded that Solomon did not actually forget any of the material, he merely found it more confusing to learn and recall. So Solomon still needed to develop a technique for forgetting. He realized that many people wrote things down in order to try to aid recall, which to him seemed ridiculous. Nevertheless, he wondered if he might write things down in order to forget. He reasoned that if something was written down, there would be no reason to continue to remember it. He tried this technique, and then discarded the pieces of paper, even burning them on occasion. Unfortunately, he found he could still see the numbers on the charred embers. It seemed to Solomon that he would be forever affected by the inability to forget, and this became an increasing worry to him. Then, out of the blue, Solomon found a method for forgetting that neither he nor the psychologists studying him fully understood. He explains that after giving three performances in one evening, he was worried about interference effects during his fourth performance. He thought, "I'll just take a look and see if the first chart of numbers is still there." I was afraid somehow that it wouldn't be. I both did and didn't want it to appear. And then I thought, the chart of numbers isn't turning up now, and it's clear why. It's because I don't want it to. Ah, that means if I don't want the chart to show up, it won't. All it took was for me to realize this. At that moment, I felt I was free. I knew that if I didn't want an image to appear, it wouldn't. Strangely, this technique of deliberately trying to forget seemed to work, although to this day, no one knows how it worked. The paradox of Solomon Sheryshevsky. So what can we make of Solomon Sheryshevsky? Solomon's life was a paradox. His greatest ability was also his greatest handicap. His amazing memory meant that he found it difficult to forget. But despite this, he did appear slow and forgetful to others. It is reported that his uncle said that Solomon only had a good memory if he consciously committed the information to memory, and that he trained hard for hours each day for his stage performances, and was frequently frustrated by the many memory experimenters who tested him and seemed to think he was some showman or charlatan. His memory created practical difficulties for him on a day-to-day basis, and he continued to have difficulty distinguishing reality from the images created in his head. He spent hours each day daydreaming on a journey through his remarkable memory. Although successful as a stage mnemonist for a time, he had many other jobs and never really found a satisfying career that exploited his astounding abilities. It is particularly difficult to draw parallels from his memory to everyday memory ability, since his capacity and processing techniques differed so markedly from the norm. Solomon ended up working as a taxi driver in Moscow, and never had any excuse for going the wrong way. There are mixed reports about what happened to Solomon, and to some extent he disappeared off the radar. The New York Times reported that he married and had one child, and that he died in 1967, aged 72. Other reports claim he ended his days in a mental asylum. Although Solomon claims he merely attended Moscow's Hospital for Diseases of the Nervous System for testing, in the hope they would find nothing wrong with him. An article in the New Yorker magazine in 2017 found strong evidence that he died in 1958 from complications arising from alcoholism. Solomon was always striving to do something great in his life, but probably felt he didn't succeed. However, his legacy to psychology may mean that in the end he actually achieved his goal. Professor Luria continued with his successful academic career until his death in 1977, and in 1972 he wrote about another famous case of a man called Zazetsky, who had suffered a major brain injury. Chapter 2. The Man Who Lived for the Present. The Story of H.M. Henry Gustav Malaysian. One summer day in 1953, brain surgeon Bill Scoville tried an experimental technique to cure one of his patients' debilitating epilepsy. With his patient still awake, he cut a hole in his head and sucked up a part of his brain through a silver straw. As he later joked, instead of removing his epilepsy, he removed his memory. H.M., as the patient was referred to, was destined to become one of the most famous neurological cases in the world. H.M.'s past. Henry Molaison, H.M., had a fairly uneventful childhood. He was born on the 26th of February 1926 in a working-class area of Hartford, Connecticut, the product of small-town America. He was a quiet, reserved and shy boy who did the typical things of his age. He'd spend time with his friends at the local soda shop and swim in the local reservoir. He had a particular interest in shooting and would spend many happy hours exploring the woods near his home, hunting for birds and pheasants for the pot. One incident that was later seized upon by doctors occurred when he was knocked unconscious by a boy on a speeding bike. 17 stitches were needed to mend the wounds to his face and head. It has been suggested that some of his subsequent neurological problems may have had their origins in this incident. On his 16th birthday, he was driving with his parents to town in order to celebrate his birthday. Suddenly, his body stiffened and he had the first of many full-blown grand mal epileptic seizures. H.M. lost consciousness. His body stiffened and yet he also began jerking uncontrollably. He bit his tongue so severely that it bled and he lost bladder control. His breathing became shallow until the jerking stopped after a minute or so. These are the classic symptoms of a grand mal seizure. These seizures are the symptoms of epilepsy. Prior to this, H.M. had noticed moments when his mind went blank, but these effects were only temporary. H.M.'s three first cousins on his father's side also had epilepsy, suggesting a family trait. Epilepsy is a neurological condition that makes people susceptible to seizures. The old name for a seizure was a fit. A seizure is caused by a temporary change in the way the brain cells work. In the enormous network of neurons that make up the brain, billions of electrical messages are fired to and fro. These determine virtually all our thoughts, feelings, and behaviours. Occasionally, without warning, an upset in brain chemistry causes these messages to become scrambled. The neurons fire faster than normal and in bursts. It is this disturbance that causes a seizure. A seizure usually only lasts a few seconds or minutes, and then the brain cells return to normal functioning. Epilepsy can be inherited, but often no cause is readily found. Unfortunately, H.M. was not treated very sympathetically by either his family or peers. He was teased at school and ended up leaving and having to graduate at a different school. On graduation day, his teachers refused to let him collect his diploma on stage in case he had a seizure. His father, Gustav, was horrified to have a mental in the family. Gustav sought solace in alcohol and left his son's future in the hands of his wife. H.M.'s plans to follow in his father's footsteps and become an electrician were abandoned, and by the age of 26 he seemed destined to a life of dead-end jobs. H.M. lived in constant fear of epilepsy, and by the summer of 1953 was having as many as 10 minor blackouts and one grand mal, major seizure, every week. His doctor made a decision to seek expert help from the local neurological hospital. There were two doctors who could have taken his case. One was Bill Scoville, who specialised in lobotomies, and the other specialised in epilepsy. Scoville took the case. The caring profession. When physicians first became interested in insanity or madness in the 1800s, they believed that the mentally ill had lost their reason, the thing that makes humans uniquely human. The mentally ill were often treated in barbaric ways, with little or no understanding of their humanity. They were often confined with physical restraints for weeks on end. Doctors were developing more and more therapies that now seem little more than innovative forms of torture. One doctor developed a gyrating chair. Another shook his patients for hours on end, and collapsing bridges were made that unexpectedly plunged patients into ice-cold water. The hope was that such treatments would restore sanity by shocking their disturbed minds. Surprisingly, many of these treatments were reported as being effective in improving manic behaviour. It seems certain that the patients were merely frightened into submission. Doctors were increasingly, desperately, searching for the cure to mental illness. In the 1930s, the incidence of serious mental illness was increasing, but an understanding of its cause, or how to treat it, was not. A Portuguese doctor called Egas Moniz was impressed when he was shown at a conference how placid a previously temperamental chimpanzee was after having had its frontal lobes removed. Moniz wondered whether a similar process would work for the mentally ill. Moniz suggested that mental illness might be caused by malfunctioning nerve cells. If these were destroyed, might not the patient show some improvement? Although Moniz had no real scientific evidence for his hypothesis, he started performing psychosurgery on human patients. Using his own subjective, biased criteria, Moniz declared the operations successful. An American professor, Walter Freeman, enthusiastically welcomed these new invasive techniques and began extolling their virtues on that side of the Atlantic. Moniz and Freeman published an influential book promoting the use of lobotomies to treat the mentally ill. The number of lobotomies performed in the United States increased from 100 in 1946 to 5,000 in 1949. The technique seemed to offer hope when none lay before. Freeman seems to have been a rebellious, controversial character. He developed a technique that involved lifting a patient's eyelid and inserting a leucotome, an instrument similar to an ice pick, through a tear duct. He would push the leucotome about an inch and a half into the frontal lobe and move the sharp tip to and fro. He would repeat this with the other eye socket. He liked to show off his skill by performing two-handed lobotomies on both eye sockets simultaneously. Being the showman he was, he ordered his own handmade leucotome to be made out of pure gold. Unbelievably, he once killed a patient when he stepped back to take a photo and accidentally allowed his leucotome to sink deep into the person's brain. Around this time, Moniz received the Nobel Prize for his discovery of the frontal lobotomy. This was later described as the most disgraceful award in the history of the prize. During this time, Scoville was studying medicine at university and could not help but be influenced by this newfound miracle procedure. Bill Scoville was also a rather wild character, known to the local police for his reckless driving in his red Jaguar and for his high-risk pranks, such as climbing the cable tower of the George Washington Bridge at night. In his professional life, he also appeared willing to take risks in the hope of gaining high rewards. Local mental hospitals used to volunteer suitable patients for pioneering operations, and Scoville would take them on. He believed in the motto of Walter Freeman, "Lobotomy gets them home." However, by 1953, concerns about the effectiveness of lobotomy were being raised. Scoville saw a chance. Could he find a new site in the brain that might be the seat of mental illness? Quite openly, he reported in the papers that he was cutting new and different areas in the brains of patients, mainly schizophrenics, and investigating the effects. In none of the papers is there any mention of ethics. Scoville reported that there had been no adverse effects, except in one case. This is the first reference to HM in any medical journal. Although Scoville had previously been warned of the dangers of his operations, HM sat in his operating chair on the 25th of August 1953. With no pain receptors in the brain, HM was awake, with a local anaesthetic administered, when Scoville started to cut across the skin on his forehead. Using a hand drill, Scoville bored two holes into his skull to access his brain. He inserted a metal spatula in order to lever up his frontal lobes to access the deeper structures within the brain. Years later, brain scans would show that his frontal lobes remained slightly pushed up and squashed. Next, he inserted a silver straw and sucked up an orange-sized mass of grey matter from both hemispheres. Specifically, Scoville removed most of the hippocampus, a small seahorse-shaped organ, the amygdala, and the entorhinal and perirhinal cortexes. Many of the functions of these areas are still not fully understood. The amygdala, for example, appears to play a part in organizing sensory and cognitive information in order to interpret the emotional significance of an event or thought. Due in no small part to the case of HM, it is now clear that the hippocampus plays a part in organizing memory storage. In a moment, HM had lost the ability to encode new memories. He was stuck in the past and the present, but with no future to look forward to. Bill Scoville had not finished his operation. He decided to place metal clips inside HM's brain in order to mark the edge of the cuts. If the operation was a success, this would enable researchers using X-rays to locate precisely where his cuts had been. However, on the first day after his operation, HM suffered another grand mal seizure. There were immediate fears that the operation had been of no benefit. However, this was not true. HM seizures did become less frequent and were reduced to about one major seizure every few months. Somewhat fortuitously, Scoville had been partially correct about his hypothesis regarding the spreading nature of the epileptic seizure within the brain. It is also now clear that the hippocampus is involved in mental illness. In both schizophrenia and some types of depression, the hippocampus appears to shrink. Unfortunately, Scoville did not foresee the intractable side effect that would afflict his patient. HM was, and remained for the rest of his life, incapable of updating his memory. Despite this, Scoville wrote on HM's discharge notes, "Condition improved." HM's memory loss was immediately apparent. His mother regretted agreeing to the operation and was angry with her husband for leaving the decision to her, and with Scoville for persuading her that there was a chance it would be a success. Scoville went home and apparently joked to his wife, "Guess what? I tried to cut out the epilepsy of a patient, but took his memory instead. What a trade!" He showed no guilt about the operation and, indeed, published papers reporting it. But at least he did warn other scientists of the dangers of precisely this sort of operation. He telephoned one of the most famous neurologists of the time, Wilder Penfield in Canada, to tell him of his patient. Penfield was angry with him and could not believe that he had conducted such a procedure, but, after calming down, decided that HM provided an opportunity to find out more about the workings of the brain. Waking from the dream. One of Penfield's colleagues, Brenda Milner, visited HM and started a systematic investigation. Largely because of her work with HM, Milner is now regarded as one of the world's leading memory researchers. HM had one of the clearest memory deficits ever documented. He found it virtually impossible to acquire any new memories at all. Although Milner worked with him for the next 20-odd years, each time he met her, she appeared as a stranger to him. From the day of the operation, HM was destined to live his life in the past. HM would often repeat the same material over and over again. He was unaware that he was repeating himself. Milner became fond of HM, but in much the same way you might develop affection for a pet. She claims he lost some uniquely human quality during the operation, since it was impossible to build a genuine friendship with a person who could not remember you from one moment to the next. So, what exactly could HM remember? He still had a normal short-term memory. He could repeat lists of numbers or letters just heard. His digit span, the number of items you can recall immediately in short-term memory, was normal. That is, he could recall approximately 7 items. He was certainly aware of what had happened a minute or so before. But beyond this, or if he was distracted, he could recall nothing. He was suffering from the most severe form of anterograde amnesia, And pterygrade amnesia refers to the loss of memory for any events after the trauma, or, in this case, the operation. In other words, he was almost totally incapable of forming any new memories. At first, HM also seemed to be suffering from retrograde amnesia, loss of memory from before the trauma. But gradually he did begin to retrieve memories from before the operation. He remembered incidents from his childhood. He recognized pictures of famous people from the 1940s. Eventually, most of his memories up to the age of 16 were retrieved. But along with his almost total inability to form any new memories, he suffered from an 11-year retrograde amnesia. That is, he could not recall events from 11 years prior to the operation. It has been suggested that this provides evidence that memories take a long time to be permanently consolidated in memory. After his operation, HM continued to live with his parents, and his mother in particular encouraged him to work to regain both his memory and his independence. For example, he would be asked to go and mow the lawn. He remembered the procedure of lawn cutting and could work out where he'd cut by judging the height of the grass. However, if his attention was diverted halfway through, he would be unaware that he was cutting the lawn. It became clear that he would be unable to lead a normal, independent life. HM occasionally surprised researchers by reporting a few memories that had been encoded after the operation. He had a vague recollection about the assassination of President Kennedy, although he often confused this with the 1933 attempt on Franklin D. Roosevelt. He learned what contact lenses were and reported that Magnum was the name of his favourite television detective. It seemed that after hundreds of repetitions, he was capable of encoding some new but often confused memories. This may be because later advanced brain scans showed that minute pieces of his hippocampus remained from the original surgery. Despite the devastating situation he found himself in, HM remained an intelligent, amusing, and polite man. His intellectual powers were not affected by the surgery. Indeed, his intelligence quotient, IQ, test scores rose after his operation from 104 to 117. The average IQ of the general population is 100. Once, a researcher accidentally locked his keys in the experimental room. HM smiled and pointed out that at least he'd know where to find them, something that HM realized would have been impossible for himself. HM continued to do crossword puzzles. He would spend hours and hours completing them, perhaps because all the clues were there on the page. He could return to them at any time and immediately see where he had got to. He continuously told visitors that he did crosswords, unaware that he was repeating himself. In a reference to his amnesic state and his love of crosswords, he once declared himself the King of Puzzles. He could still read and write, but read the same rifle magazine over and over again. Each time he forgot that he had previously read it. As with many amnesiacs, HM developed strategies to try to hide his memory loss. For a number of years after the operation, HM worked in a machine tool shop, doing menial repetitive jobs. He could do these, so long as he didn't stop or was distracted. if he went to the toilet, he would never find his way back. His supervisor used to ask him to collect tools. He would give him the picture of the tool that he required, and then HM would usually succeed in locating it. HM also learned to notice subtle, non-verbal cues that familiar acquaintances exhibited. These helped him to realise that these were people he should have known. However, this was not always the case. When he returned home to live with his mother soon after the operation, he would invite all callers to the house in for a cup of tea. He assumed that all callers must be friends, and, not wishing to appear rude, invited everyone in. Eventually, the research on HM switched to the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, MIT, and a former student of Milner's called Suzanne Corkin took charge in 1966 and continued to test HM three times per year until his death in 2009. At this time, HM's anonymity ceased, and we found out his real name was Henry Mollison. After the operation, Henry had no idea of his own age or the date. He believed he was about 33 years of age, and often guessed the year to be about 1930. He was often shocked when he saw his reflection in the mirror. Indeed, he had been known not to recognise current pictures of himself. When he was shown a picture of Muhammad Ali, he said that it was Joe Lewis. He didn't remember the operation, but was aware that he had a problem with memory loss. He was often worried that he may have said something that may have been upsetting to others, and that he couldn't remember it. He constantly worried about this and asked people if that was the case. He did seem to realise that his situation could help others. He once said, "I keep thinking that possibly I had an operation. Somehow the memory is gone. I'm trying to figure it out. It isn't worrisome in a way to me. They'd learn from it. It would help others." Although cheerful, for the most part, Henry did occasionally show hurt at being referred to as a case. He described his life as like waking from a dream. Every day is alone in itself. He found it difficult to hold conversations and ask questions, because he was aware that he couldn't remember what went just before. He often reverted to telling a dozen or so anecdotes that he repeated over and over again for the last 50 years of his life. Psychological tests showed that Henry was extremely poor at estimating time. Beyond 20 seconds, he seemed incapable of accurately estimating it. His estimations were so poor that researchers believed that, to him, a few days passed like minutes, weeks like hours, and years like weeks. This may have been a godsend for someone in Henry's position, since it would mean that his last 50 years of memory loss may have seemed no longer than a few months. Henry's gift to science. One of Henry's gifts to science was the discovery that there are many different forms of memory and that they are located in different areas of the brain. His memory loss involved the processing of memory, that is, the forming, sorting, and storing of new memories. This seems to be a major role of the hippocampus. Not only does it file away new memories, but it connects them with related memories and thus helps to give the new memories meaning. It is possible to determine whether amnesiacs can learn new things without them being consciously aware of it. Henry managed to learn a number of procedural memories. Procedural memories, sometimes called muscle memory or implicit knowledge, involve the storage of skills and procedures. This includes memories of skilled tasks, such as playing tennis, swimming, or riding a bike. Memories such as this are most easily demonstrated by performing the actual skill. People have great difficulties describing procedural memories. For example, try describing the front crawl swimming stroke to someone. Specifically, procedural memory is now thought to comprise three types. 1. Conditioned reflexes. 2. Emotional associations. And 3. Skills and habits. Each of these memories are related to different areas of the brain. The learning of conditioned reflexes is thought to be related to the brain structure called the cerebellum. The most famous example of this was reported by Claparède in 1911. One of his amnesic patients never remembered him from one meeting to the next. One day, Claparède held a pin in his hand and pricked her when shaking hands. Next time they met, the patient again did not recognize him, but refused to shake his hand. She could not explain why, but was very reluctant to do so. This is an example of simple conditioning, learning. Henry's cerebellum was unaffected by his operation, and so we would expect that he should have been able to acquire and learn things in this way, even though he would not have been aware of having learned it. However, conditioning tests on Henry had to be abandoned when it was found that he had an abnormally high tolerance to electric shocks. He seemed able to tolerate shocks that any normal person would find painful. The exact reasons for this remain unclear, but it is suggested that this must be another symptom of his widespread neurological damage. Emotional associations, such as knowing when to feel afraid or angry, are related to the amygdala. Much of this brain structure was removed in Henry, and although he did appear to feel fear and anger, he was unaware of why he felt such emotions. For example, since the operation, Henry occasionally showed extreme outbursts of anger. He once broke a finger when he banged his fists repeatedly against his bedroom door, shouting, "I can't remember! I can't remember!" And he threatened to kill himself on at least one occasion. There were fears that he was beginning to realize how empty his life had become due to his memory loss. However, most often he could not remember why he was angry, nor indeed his actual display of anger. It seemed that the feelings of anger arose, but he could not remember why he felt angry. This in itself must have been a frustrating and confusing situation. It is still unclear which brain structures are associated with the skills and habits of procedural memory. Both the cerebellum and hippocampus are thought to be implicated. Henry could demonstrate the acquisition and retention of new skills. For example, Corkin taught him the technique of mirror drawing. This involves tracing a drawing onto paper while only viewing the image of it in a mirror. At first, this is extremely difficult, but with sufficient practice, people soon improve on the task. Henry showed normal learning ability for the task. But on subsequent occasions, when he was asked to perform the task, he was totally unaware that he had learned the particular skill. Later on, he also learned the techniques of mirror writing and mirror reading. These examples echo the case of an amnesic patient who learned to play table tennis to a good standard, but was unaware of his ability, or indeed the rules of the game, or how to keep score. Another amnesic pianist was taught a new piece of music. Later, he could not recall it, but after being given the first few notes, he could play the tune perfectly. What was missing from Henry was the ability to encode new memories for episodes that occurred in his life. For example, his birthday. This type of memory is called episodic memory. Henry could not store the events in his life, but had also lost the ability to learn new factual information. For example, who the President of the United States was. This type of memory is called semantic memory. It is clear that the brain structures that Henry lost were not involved in procedural memory, but are essential for retaining episodic and semantic memories. Henry's legacy. So, how can we summarize what we learned from the 50-year study of Henry? Researchers found that short-term memory is not located in the hippocampus, that there are different forms of long-term memory, that the hippocampus is not involved in the encoding or retaining of procedural memories, that the hippocampus is involved in the formation of new episodic and semantic long-term memories, and that personality is not greatly affected by the loss of the hippocampus. Henry was always described as a lovely, gentle man who remained intelligent, friendly, and altruistic. He always tried hard in the memory tests with 100 or more neuroscientists he encountered over the years. It seems that the botched operation did not change his personality. Henry outlived his family, but he never had any recollection of their deaths. When he was told about his mother's death, he grieved afresh each time. However, he did sometimes report that he had a feeling that she may have left him somehow. With his intellect intact, by estimating what his age might be from looking in a mirror, he could deduce that it was most likely that his mother was dead. In a striking contrast to many of the researchers that dealt with other cases, such as Jeannie, whom we'll see in Chapter 10, Suzanne Corkin, who spent much of her academic career studying Henry, became a guardian of him, looking after his interests and helping to organise various aspects of his life. She helped him in the nursing home in which he resided up to his death and arranged his research visits to MIT. She ensured his medical needs were met and sent him gifts at Christmas and on his birthday. She became a valuable advisor to Henry, despite the fact that he never truly remembered her. Henry had a vague sense of familiarity for Corkin and seemed to think that they had been in high school together. It seems such a shame that Suzanne Corkin's amazing and altruistic efforts to help Henry for over 50 years did not make a lasting impression on him. Henry always stated that he wanted to help others in a similar predicament, and he and his court-appointed guardian gave consent for his brain to be donated to science on his death. As Corkin put it in 2002, his wish to help other people will have been fulfilled. Sadly, however, he will remain unaware of his fame and of the impact that his participation in research has had on scientific and medical communities internationally. People have often pondered what life would be like without memory. Without memory, where would the human race be? There would be no language, no science, no art, no history, no family, no meaningful existence. Our existence would be from moment to moment. We would only have our innate reflexes to cope with the world, a world that would be completely different from the one we know today. Because of Henry, we can answer some of those questions. It may be possible to view Henry's memory loss as a blessing in some respects. Henry's memory loss also served to protect him from fully realizing what a meaningless life he led after his operation. The case of Henry is tragically ironic. The man without a memory has taught us so much about the nature of memory, and will continue to do so to this day. When told of his massive contribution to brain science, he would quickly forget it. But it would also make him very happy, if only for a few seconds. Henry Molaison died of respiratory failure, aged 82, on the 2nd of December 2009, at his Connecticut nursing home. As previously agreed, Suzanne Corkin arranged for his brain to be taken to the Brain Observatory at the University of California, San Diego. His brain was dissected and sliced into specimen segments during a 53-hour live web broadcast in order to allow researchers to access his brain in the future. Corkin has revealed plans to write a memoir of her time working with Henry, and the film rights to Henry's life story have recently been sold to Columbia Pictures. It seems that the man with no memory will never be forgotten. Chapter 3. The Man Who Was Disappointed with What He Saw. The Story of S.B. S.B. lost his sight, aged 10 months. His particular eyesight problem was declared inoperable. However, many years later, science had progressed to the point where his sight was restored. At the age of 52, S.B. could see again. He would see his wife for the first time, and everything else besides. He would surely be delighted with his newly restored gift of sight. However, he quickly became dispirited, depressed, and within 2 years died a broken man. He was disappointed with what he saw. The Life of a Blind Child. S.B. was born in 1906. He was one of seven children born into a relatively poor home in Birmingham, UK. He became blind at the age of 10 months due to an infection following a smallpox vaccination. His elder sister used to take S.B. to his weekly eye clinic sessions in order to have his bandages removed and for his eyes to be cleaned. She reports that his eyes were continually bandaged since his eyes wept so much with an unpleasant discharge. As a game, the family used to test SB's vision, and she recalls his ability to distinguish light and to be able to point to some large white objects. He could also distinguish hand movements at a distance of about 8 inches with his right eye. However, for the most part during his childhood, SB's head was covered in a bandage. He himself reported that he had only 3 visual memories, these being the colours red, white, and black. To all intents and purposes, he led the life of a blind child. He attended the Birmingham Blind School from the age of 9 and left with a good education and the skills necessary to be a cobbler in 1923. During these school years, he was described as a good, nice-mannered and smart boy, only occasionally disobedient. He started work as a boot repairer in a garden shed at his home in Burton-on-Trent. All his tools and equipment were provided for him. The quality of his work was reported as good, and he led a largely independent existence. And yet he earned only a meagre wage compared to his sighted colleagues. He set up home, married, and is reported as being a jovial and active person. He was confident enough to cross any road unaided and generally would not carry a white cane when going out. It was not unknown for him to injure himself by walking into parked cars or other unexpected obstructions on his familiar routes to the pub or shops. He was a keen cyclist and would go for long rides, holding onto a friend's shoulder for guidance. He enjoyed gardening and was described as a positive and enthusiastic person who embraced life. Such was his life, relatively uneventful but full, until a routine eye examination in 1957 opened the door for him to regain his sight. The ophthalmic surgeon, Mr. Hertenstein, tested SB and suggested that since he was not actually blind, technically this means totally insensitive to light, there might be an operation that could improve his corneal functioning and thus restore his sight. The cornea is the window at the front of the eye. It should be transparent and allow light to enter the eye. When this cannot occur, the path of light to the retina is distorted and/or blocked, with a corresponding loss of vision. A corneal graft involves removing a part of the cornea and replacing it with a similar piece from a donor eye. Advancement in surgical techniques meant that such operations were now possible, and on the 9th of December 1958 he received a corneal graft on his left eye, to be followed a month later with a similar operation on the right. A national newspaper, the Daily Express, got to hear about this and reported the case. A psychology professor called Richard Gregory read the story and immediately wrote to the surgeon requesting access to his patient. To this day, Gregory remains one of the world's leading experts in visual perception. Gregory and his assistant, Jean Wallace, were given the necessary consent and visited SB 48 days after the operation on his left eye. Restored sight. SB's first visual experience.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.